first things first, I'ma say all the words inside my head. I'm fired up and tired of the way that things have been. Oh, ooh, the way that things have been. Oh, ooh. Second thing, second, don't you tell me what you think that I can be. I'm the one at the sail, I'm the master of my sea. Oh, I was broken from a young age, taking my soak into the masses, writing my poems for the few that look at me, took to me, shook at me, feeling me, singing from heartache, from the pain, taking my message from the veins, speaking my lesson from the brain, seeing the beauty through the...
appropriate lab attire before beginning the lab.
Rinse all glassware with distilled water to remove any leftover chemicals.
Dry beakers to remove any excess water.
Measure out 25 ml of carbonic acid in a beaker.
Then, record the pH of the carbonic acid to make sure it's actually acidic.
Record the pH for future reference.
At this point in the lab, something undoubtedly would have gone wrong, so ask Scaringi for help.
Make sure the burette is closed before adding solution.
Pour the measured out amount of carbonic acid into the burette.
Measure out 100 ml of seawater in a graduated cylinder.
Pour the seawater into the beaker that will be used for the titration. And place it on the hot plate. But now
I hold my head up high. Plug in all necessary interface into the computer.
Go ahead and have a chat about life while you wait.
Now I'm saving all my loving for someone who's loving me. Go on now, go.
And when the computer still doesn't load, continue on chatting.
Open up Logger Pro as appropriate.
Plug in pH sensor into the vernier connector thing.
Swirl the seawater around with a pH meter in order to stabilize the pH.
Now it's time to begin the titration. Add drops of acid into the seawater in intervals and record the volume each time.
Please don't forget to put the stir rod in.
Every time.
Keep titrating until you reach the end of the buffering capacity and the pH drastically starts to change.
We'll be right back.
So this is our pH graph for the titration of carbonic acid with seawater. And as you can see, after adding 1.25 mil of carbonic acid, the pH begins to drop drastically, which means that this section right here is our buffer region, which we'll use for later calculations and applications. So we determine the volume of carbonic acid in Puget Sound necessary to end its buffer region. And so for that, we took the molarity of carbonic acid in club soda, which is 0.0100, and the molarity of carbonic acid in the ocean, which is 0.83893 molarity. And we set up an equation to find the molarity of the carbonic acid in our own solution. So we multiplied the club soda molarity by the volume that we used to end our buffer region over the total volume of the solution. And we got 1.23 times 10 to the negative 4 molarity of H2CO3 in our own solution. And after this, we set up a ratio to figure out the liters of carbonic acid in Puget Sound to end its buffer region. And so what we did is we set up our own molarity of carbonic acid over the liters of carbonic acid that we had in our solution. And we set that equal to the molarity of carbonic acid in Puget Sound over X amount of liters. And we ended up calculating X to be 9.04 liters.
Okay, so as you could see from the calculation section that we just did, we calculated the amount of volume that could enter the Puget Sound before the pH drastically starts to change to be 9.04 liters. And while that doesn't seem to be that big of an amount when you look at it scientifically, it's a large amount considering how concentrated the acid actually is. The acid was 0.893, which is very close to 1 molar, which is really, really concentrated. So that just shows how humans shouldn't underestimate the significance that carbon dioxide has on pH levels in the Puget Sound.
We also found that since the Industrial Revolution started in around 1800, carbonic acid emissions have increased by 30%, which if you think about that rate of increase, if that's expected to continue and even exponentially grow, that carbon emissions will like surpass what they've ever been before, and that'll have uncountable devastating effects on environments like Puget Sound and therefore the rest of the ocean. So yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Carbon dioxide.
Dangerous.
Mm-hmm.
All my friends are heathens, take it slow. Wait for them to...
Okay, so we are focusing on our two main errors from this whole process, but you should know we had so many errors that the whole process for one titration took 7 days of us just labbing and redoing the same process, trying to fix all of our problems. But anyways, the first error that we had was initially what we planned on doing was mixing sea salt with distilled water to mimic the same conditions that seawater actually had on this subject. But the stupid sea salt bought from Home Goods.
Don't trust it.
Yeah. When we mixed it into the distilled water, it made it acidic. Which makes no sense because seawater is supposed to be basic with a pH of 8.5. So basically what happened was that we were titrating an acidic solution with another acid. Which obviously, as you can see, created a lot of error.
Our second main source of error was when we came up with the second lab design, we were going to titrate a strong acid, HCl, with seawater, which is supposed to be a weak base. So we titrated 0.1 molar HCl with seawater, like legit seawater from Puget Sound, not the sea salt solution this time. And what happened was our pH graph decreased a little bit, then we added like 2 drops of solution and it shot down 3 pH levels. Which as you can imagine would make it kind of hard to analyze because we have like a cliff for a pH graph. And so that was our second source of error. So after that we titrated just carbonic acid with seawater, which is a weak titration. And that also kind of made for some error because it's hard to analyze something that doesn't have as steep a transition. As you can see, our graph that is not zoomed in, looks like this. And if you look really closely, that's our buffer region, which zoomed in like crazy, gives us that. And that little thing is our buffer region. That, by the way, is like the size of my fingernail. So that created its own problems, but ultimately the weak titration was the way to go. Please don't make any
sudden moves. As you can see through this lab, there's a specific buffering capacity for seawater that can only withstand a certain amount of carbonic acid before the pH drastically starts to change. So human beings, especially in this modern age, should be wary of their actions regarding carbon dioxide fuel emissions, because it can have serious impacts on the ocean pH levels.
And one of the most major effects of increased carbonic acid is on shelled organisms, which devastates their shells and their environment. And they play a key role in the greater balance of ocean ecosystems, which is why dealing with carbon fuel emissions, we need to take into consideration our impacts on the world around us when producing more fuel.